Thank you very much, Amy, for the nice introduction. So I don't have to do that myself anymore. So today's agenda, we will start off with an introduction about ourselves. We will dive a little bit more in depth in what we usually do. We will give a brief introduction about fault injection. We will give a brief overview where the fault injection field is at the moment. We will touch briefly on trends, and really the body of our talk will be debunking some of the myths we hear quite often, either after we gave a talk or when we discuss these fault injection attacks with other people, then these things keep on popping back. So we thought it's valuable to touch upon these things and maybe explain them with some proof that these things are not really the case. And of course we'll finalize with some takeaways. So who are we? Christopher can introduce himself, I think.
Yeah, well, thank Amy for the very nice introduction. It's a great pleasure to be here. Thank you, Hack in the Box, to have the opportunity to stay again with you. So I'm Christopher Mune. I am a product security consultant and a security trainer, mostly focuses on low-level stuff. My research has been fault injection, mostly with Nick and with much pleasure. Trusted execution environment. You might find papers also from me by on white box cryptography and device exploitation, which I do happen to enjoy. And Nick?
Yeah, so recently I left Riskier, which is a company specialized in hardware security, in order to start for myself. So I'm a freelance device security expert. I also do trainings. I'm really interested in the area where the software is tightly coupled with the hardware. So where the software, where the hardware is still fundamentally present. So embedded device security, things like secure boot, fault injection. And over the last few years, I've been doing quite a bit of automotive research as well. So anybody here in the room has an idea what I mean with when I mention fault injection, what that is about, or another word for these type of attacks is glitching attacks. So for the ones that are not familiar with this, I will give a brief introduction. So when we talk about fault injection attacks, we talk really about introducing faults into a chip in order to alter its intended behavior. So for example, if you look at this code snippet, which for example can be used to authenticate an image during boot, so typically you see something like this in a secure boot implementation, you see that there is a flag being read from OTP in order to determine if the image will be authenticated or not. So if you would change the image that's stored in flash, this piece of code will actually make sure that that code cannot be executed because the authentication will simply fail. So this is exactly what you can change using fault injection. You can change the intended behavior of this software in order to bypass the authentication that's being performed. And this allows you to load an image that is unsigned. And this effectively allows you to compromise the device from an early start without actually having any access to the keys that are being used for the authentication. And of course, these faults that you want to introduce, they need to be injected somehow. And that can be done using various ways. So when we talk about faults, we really talk about injecting glitches into a chip in order to make that chip temporarily run outside of its intended conditions, and that manifests itself as a fault, either in the software or in the hardware. So for example, if you look at an embedded device, for example, this simple PCB, you see that you need to provide a stable voltage signal and a stable clock signal in order for this device to operate correctly. And these signals need to be between certain boundaries. If they're not between those boundaries, which are typically set up by the chip manufacturer, then this chip will not function correctly. And this is exactly what we exploit using fault injection. We, for example, pull the voltage down at a very specific moment in time. For example, during that piece of code that's used for the authentication is being executed. And if we do that at the right amount of time, at the right amount of amplitude, we can actually make changes in the intended behavior of this chip without affecting its continuation. And we can do it in a similar fashion for the clock, so we can either slow down the clock or make it faster for a brief moment in time, in order to also create these hiccups in the circuit that allows you to change what's going on in this chip. Differently than the signals that the chip already relies on, you can inject these glitches also using various other means. For example, you can use an electromagnetic field in order to inject these interruptions within the chip circuit. Or when you open the chip package, you can, for example, shoot lasers at a chip in order to add additional power, which makes the transistor switch when they shouldn't. And this also allows you to inject these corruptions within the chip circuit in order to change either the software or the hardware. And one thing to realize is that even the temperature, the ambient temperature around the chip has an impact on the condition of the chip. For example, you probably know that when your laptop gets very hot, it will actually shut down. And that's because it's not guaranteed anymore that this chip will function as intended and will probably crash and you lose your data. And this is exactly what's going on. You inject kind of a glitch and that results into a fault that prevents the device from operating correctly. So where is the research field now? Well, there's quite a lot of research being conducted. For example, there's even conferences completely tailored around fault injection research. There's various academic papers at various conferences. For example, typically at USENIX or the USENIX workshop, you see at least a few papers which talk about fault injection, either performing attacks or implementing defenses. And also at the security community conferences, which there are a lot in the world, every year there's more and more of these contributions being done. For example, an early example was glitching for noobs by Excite at Recon 2014. But since then, we've seen way more presentations about doing fault injection on a wide variety of devices. And the reason for this is because the tooling nowadays is a bit easier available than it used to be, for example, 10 years ago. Nowadays, you can just go to GitHub and there will be various designs in order to make your own little glitcher in order to perform voltage glitching, for example. An example is the chip fill glitcher, which was used recently in order to target various targets. Also, there's nowadays affordable commercial tooling available. For example, the products that are created by new IE, the Chip Whisperer, they can be simply bought for less than $1,000 with some extras that you need in order to perform these attacks. And they allow you to perform these fault injection attacks with off-the-shelf hardware, which is something you could not do 10 years ago, because then only professional tooling was available, which is quite expensive. The advantage of this professional tooling is that it supports a wide variety of injection techniques. But we'll talk a little bit about that later. And also because there's research being done, there's tooling available, there's all sorts of attacks being conducted. For example, there's attacks on crypto wallets, there's attacks on smartphones, there's attacks on secure boot, and there's even attacks on hardware cryptographic engines. And this shows that fault injection is a very versatile tool that can be used to mount all sorts of different attacks. So we will dive a little bit into these things in the remainder of this presentation as well. So some important trends that we would like to touch upon, and one of the things I mentioned, tooling is becoming available to the masses, so we will see much more research than, let's say, 10 years ago. At the moment, there's still lots of focus on the how to inject the glitch and what tooling to use to inject this glitch. Whereas we are more interested in what can you do with this glitch. So the glitches result in faults, and what can you do with these faults in order to compromise the security of the device. So we think that once the market for the tooling and the experience of people with this tooling kind of matured, they will also move on to the next step, which is actually using these glitches for specific attacks. We will touch upon that a little bit as well today. Most research is conducted on low-power chips, which is not necessarily a problem. I mean, low-power chips still include an ARM core and they still execute complex software. But some of the devices that we are interested in and are actually using high-power chips. So examples are, for example, the gaming consoles, mobile phones, set-top boxes, devices like this. And also, the focus at the moment is mostly on altering the software rather than altering the behavior of the hardware. And it's important to realize that you can do much more than just changing the software that's being executed. And of course, for every trend, there's some very important examples. Optical fault injection, so shooting lasers at chips, this is not something that's available to the masses. The tooling that you need for this is quite expensive or not easy to obtain, so it's a bit more complicated to do this. Also considering that for the setup, you probably need to open the chip with some chemicals, and that is also not really something that the masses will be conducting. There's whole research groups at academia that do not really focus on the injection part. They just take it for granted that you can cause some bit flips within the target, and they research around that. So a field where they do this a lot is, for example, differential fault analysis. And of course, real attackers, and with real attackers, I mean attackers that really have a goal. They really don't care. They just have a target in mind. They want to attack and they make it work. So they don't really focus on low power chips, or they focus on just altering software. They just try to attack whatever they have in their hand. And this means that, for example, devices like gaming consoles, which are designed around high power chips, are being hacked with fault injection. So where do we fit in, Cristoforo?
Yeah, I think we fit in quite well, but first let's share what we're working on at the moment. Well, first we bundled up together with a few friends of ours, Alyssa Milburn and Albert Sprout. We all have quite some experience in performing fault injection testings and attacks. And, well, you might here in the near future of a think tank called All Our Faults. You can find us on Twitter, on the web, and we plan to use this channel to regulate a bit more of what we're doing. We're working on an open source voltage glitching platform. This is already a prototype that is existing. We are already using for doing some tests. It's in its infancy and so on. So there will come the point in time where this will be released. Let's see if we can actually are able to show something during these few days. We will surely let you know. And we are performing fault injection research, of course, and some results also covered in this presentation. More and more, we focus it on the parts which we find more interesting. So let's assume that some faults can happen. How can we creatively use them in different ways for achieving things which are unexpected? Because what's happening now is that the fault injection theory in academia has been quite well established. I mean, the first attacks happened on smart cards, like in the 90s, things like that. So it's quite an old kind of attacks. So people are expecting a number of things in terms also of defenses, in terms of attacks, and we like to instead to explore different corners. And this is what we try to do in our research. You can find us on All Our Faults on Twitter and also on the web. We published a few things already which might be interesting to share. We might pinpoint during the rest of the presentation here. The first one, we'd like to mention our academic contribution, which we think are quite relevant to this presentation as well. Well, Nick, with Albert Sprout and Mark Wittmann in 2016, they presented a way of directly controlling the program counter on ARMv7. So it's not a matter anymore of, let's say, what can you do with actually random, which is precise control of the program counter. And we used this technique in 2017, which has been presented at several conferences, in order to escalate the privilege from user space Linux to get control of kernel with a program counter, using voltage fault injection and without having, say, the need of any software vulnerabilities, just by using that. Along that, we have also had several community contributions, first by passing circuit boards using fault injection. Again, Albert and Nick really did a great job on this. We extended a bit of our results in 2019, where we presented how to bypass a secure boot, but with encryption on top, without having the need of a key. So basically, we need one glitch, no key needed, and we can bypass that kind of secure boot, even if there is encryption on top. And also, we explored a bit of few kind different possibilities in another presentation. So there is lots of research has been done, but there are still many myths and misconceptions in this field. And this is something that we would like to debunk in a systematic fashion. And I would like to give back to Dick on this part.
Yeah, so when we talk about systematic fashion, we really talk about using a reference model in order to discuss some of the things we'll be touching upon today. And we like to use this reference model in order to discuss fault attacks. So this is all modeled from an attacker point of view, but it can also be used from a designer point of view if you, for example, want to put defenses for a particular system. So it all starts with a target. And there's always a goal. So you want to accomplish something on this target. For example, you want to bypass secure boot on this target, or you want to attack some other security feature on this target. And one of the assumptions you then make when you start performing fault injection attacks is that you assume that there will be a hardware vulnerability within this target. Because this is fundamental for a fault injection. We are actually exploiting hardware vulnerabilities within the chip. And whether that results into changing software or a hardware feature, that does not really matter. And we trigger these hardware vulnerabilities using various injection techniques, which we already touched upon. So these injection techniques, they include voltage, but also clock, EM. And basically, this reference model can be used for any technique. So it even includes, at the moment, techniques we are not aware of yet. Because we can imagine that this will maybe change in the future, right? It's always new attacks will be, and new techniques will be invented. So these injection techniques are used to generate a glitch. But it's important to realize that this glitch is not something arbitrary. This glitch needs to have a certain shape, so you need to tune the parameters of this glitch in a way to make sure that this glitch actually is capable of triggering that hardware vulnerability. So for example, when you talk about voltage glitching, you talk about how wide the pulse is, for example, and for how deep you pull it down. And when you, for example, talk about optical fault injection, where you shoot lasers at the chip, you talk about how large is the spot size, for how long do I keep the laser on, things like this, the things that shape the glitch. And then once this glitch is used to trigger this vulnerability, then this hardware vulnerability actually manifests itself within the chip as a fault. And these faults can mean anything. They can mean bit flips, they can mean instruction being skipped, it can mean that the instruction gets corrupted, it can mean anything. And it's important from an attacker point of view, but also from a defender point of view, to describe these faults. So somehow you need to come up with fault models that can be tightly coupled to the faults that are happening. The advantage of this is that even though you do not know exactly what faults are happening when you start glitching, you can already make some reasoning about the faults that are being done. And if you have enough and sufficient fault models, then probably you cover much of the space of what these faults actually will do in the chip. So an attacker will just assume a specific fault model. For example, I can flip two bits in an instruction. And it uses that model in order to mount the attack. So the exploit is actually designed around the fault model. So you just assume that you have some primitive in hand and you can use this primitive to do something. And for example, as Christopher showed, we use this to escalate privileges in Linux, for example. One thing that's important here is that these injection techniques are not only hardware driven. It's not only that you need hardware tooling to do so. There's also variants where you can actually drive from software. So that means, and we'll touch upon this later a little bit, that you can trigger these hardware vulnerabilities from software. So some examples are clock screw and rowhammer. If you do not know what these things are, don't worry, we will touch upon these in a little bit more detail later in the presentation. So let's focus on some myths. So one thing we often hear is that high speed chips, so let's say above 1 GHz, it's very difficult to pull off fault injection attacks. Because there's just so many instructions being executed in a short amount of time, the granularity of your glitches is such large compared to the time, this will probably not work. Well, the research that Christopher already referred to, where we escalate privileges in Linux, was actually done on a chip that was running at 1 GHz. So in the paper we already showed that on a vanilla version of Linux, on a common development board, so the chip is commonly used for all sorts of products, it is possible to pull off these sophisticated attacks where you actually inject glitches during the runtime of a full-blown operating system in order to change the intended behavior of the software in the Linux kernel. So we like to say that this myth doesn't really hold up. It might be hard to think that these attacks are applicable on these fast chips, but they really are. It's not a problem to make the right faults with certain type of glitches. But of course, this is voltage. There's a whole wide variety of other injection techniques. So what about EMFI? Well, in 2017, a very nice paper came out where the researchers actually developed a do-it-yourself EMFI tool that allow you to inject an electromagnetic field in the chip in order to cause glitches that manifest itself as faults. However, they made an incorrect statement on EMFI in this paper. And this is not bashing in any way, this is just being unaware of the results that were already presented earlier, is that here they state that these attacks are not applicable to chips that are running above 100 MHz, and that the literature actually states so. Well, we like to stress that not everybody is aware of all the research that's being done in the fault injection field. Because, for example, in 2014 already, somebody showed that it was possible to inject glitches with EMFI in a fast-running chip running at 1 GHz. And actually, another person in 2014 did exactly the same on a chip that was running at a slightly slower speed, but still 800 MHz, in order to take control of a device, modify instructions at the granularity of one instruction using EMFI. So we would like to stress is that there somehow is some, I would like to debunk the myth, but I would like to stress that there's somehow some fragmentation in the research being done. Because there's fault injection research being done at multiple communities. For example, there's the academia doing research, there's the industry doing research, there's the security community doing research. However, consolidation of the knowledge that's being acquired within those communities does not always happen. And it's kind of a shame, because actually there's lots of cool things happening in all these communities, and it would be cool if they actually communicate more often, they would see each other more at conferences in order to share their experiences, and that would hopefully prevent, I would not say mistakes, but this incomplete view of fault injection attacks to actually slip into recent research. So like I said, research is being missed because of that, so and this is the main reason why these myths and misconceptions are there, we believe, and that's also the reason why we're here, is because there's an inconsistent view within those communities. And even when we discuss fault injection attacks, also with the people that Christopher actually mentioned, so this is Albert and Alyssa, even between us four, we have large discussions which are also based sometimes on just having an inconsistent view. Because it's quite a complex topic where physics and all sorts of other things come together and which you need to know in order to reason about these attacks properly. Let's do another myth. And I think this is one for Christoffer.
Yep. Thank you, Nick.
Indeed, the fields are actually being shaped, and also in the way that things are described, they're commented upon, there is not a clear view at the moment. So we are trying to, even just having a reference model to, just to start with, to start the discussion in these main elements. There is one big myth which says that mostly fault attacks or fault injection is used to bypass software checks. So this means that if you have a software check, then you may be able to bypass your default injection. But for some reason, in the practitioner's mind, sometimes this goes the other way around. If you don't have software checks, then you are not able to perform fault injection. Actually, this is not true, because this is the way you are perceiving your attack, like you're actually doing that. Instead, there are examples, beautiful examples, that you can perform beautiful fault attacks without necessarily relying on any checks in software. Let's have a few examples on that. So, a bit of more on the attacks we were mentioning before. So, we were in user space, okay? So, we are Linux and that's an application. We are trying to do a syscall. You see, the GSRMv7 SWI is the calling a syscall towards the Linux kernel for, let's say, from user space. And you pre-populate all the available registers with a number, in this case, with an address. An address which is valid in kernel memory space. In this case, just because we wanted to see the crash, we populated it with 41, 41, 41, 41. It's the iconic number that usually used in many exploits. So before doing this syscalls, you pre-populate all the registers which can be pre-populated, so they are actually free during syscall, and then you actually call, you request the syscall to the kernel. You can see that there are trigger high and trigger low. They show the region where you want to shoot with your fault injection. You want to inject a fault. So if you're doing, let's say, voltage glitching, you will lower your voltage enough to inject some fault. If you're doing clock fault injection, then you will vary the fault within the time. EM, you will just provide a difference in the EM field, an injection, a glitch over there, a laser, same stuff. So whatever you need to do needs to happen within the point in time. And chances are that in some architecture, this may be easier than others, that your syscall is performed, but you are shooting and you are causing one of those addresses to enter in the program counter. And you see here in the picture that PC, which is the kernel program counter, is now set exactly at the value that you wanted. So now imagine for the exploitation that you have a way where your memory is accessible from kernel space. This is a usual situation for kernel exploitation. You need to find a way for reaching user space, shell code placed in user space from kernel memory. That is an address in kernel memory. So what we should be doing is that placing the shell code in user space, reachable from kernel, and then at that point, preprobably all the registers with the destination address where the user space shellcode is shoot, and chances are that if the program counter is set to the address, immediately the program counter will start executing your shellcode. This has been proven in 2017, so we were able to do that, and what you're seeing there is a screenshot of the program counter in kernel space being set in 41. So from a setup point of view, well, apart from the injection part, there was nothing so much to be prepared. We just do that. And the software, no known software vulnerability, okay? So the system were fully patched. It was just an ARMv7. So this shows how this task can be powerful. So you get this, which can be an holy grail, let's say, in a mobile phone, which is very well defended. And please don't tell anyone there were no software checks involved. Indeed. The second one that we would like to discuss is that in principle, you could use fault injection in order to flip bits in memory. Let's assume that you have a verification. Normally, you will have, for example, just an RSA key, maybe as well an ECC key, public key that you're going to use in order to verify the signature or something. Well, cryptographers know that even if you flip one bit in the modulus of RSA key, there is a very high chance that the resulting public key will be much weaker for to factorization, basically. So if you change that modulus, you will get another key in memory for which you can compute very likely the private key. So at this point, if you can compute that, you can actually sign your image with your new key corresponding to the one which is in kernel space or in your secure boots or wherever in your application. And then this means that you can load your own firmware image with sign with your own key. This has been demonstrated in 2018 by Evo, but it's also been performed as part of other attacks. It closed through and also been told that also Roamer has been used for doing that. So this means it's not a new technique, but you start thinking fault injection in a different way than just bypassing software check. The last one, why only software? In principle, you could affect also just directly the hardware. Think about hardware crypto system or hardware engines which do perform the crypto computation. This again happens in console, happens in mobile phone, and the key is used by the hardware, but it's never reachable. Ever. So there are a number of attacks which rely, which are called differential fault attacks, which rely on the fact that when you do inject a glitch in a crypto calculation performed on the hardware engine, chances are that it will give you a faulty output, a wrong one. And there are techniques elaborated and investigated by the academia that if you collect enough of these faulty outputs and the glitch happens at the right point in time, the fault that you have been introducing, you can reconstruct the public key. You might think this as a, let's say, a pretty mythological attack. Actually, it is the one that allowed Ethan Liu, by the way, shout out to him, we are really big fan of his research, to recover 30 master keys on PS Vita and 238 out of 240. And you might guess, where are the other two? Well, they were just not relevant. And that's why they chose not to retrieve them, basically. So all the hardware keys which were hidden in hardware, not accessible, just used by the system, were retrieved by using this kind of attacks. So we do think that this is not true, that you can use them only for software checks. So if you hear someone that says, well, you don't know where to attack, there is no conditional, there is no checking point, well, just drop that, because it actually is something that we think is not proper. Nick, who's going to the next one, right?
So another thing I have heard more often than once is that fault attacks are not very effective on multiple core chips. Because when you think about it, if you have a double core or a quad core chip, these cores are all executing software at the same moment in time. So what are the chances that you can change the behavior of a specific piece of software? Well, I think that reasoning is not flawed at all. Multiple cores definitely have an impact on a fault injection attack. But one thing to realize is that fault injection is typically also a statistical problem to inject the right shape of the glitch at the right moment in time. So there's still windows of time where you can inject a glitch in order to change one particular piece of the software that's being executed, even though it is executed at the same time with other software. So what the research has already shown is that even this is possible when cores are being used to verify each other in lockstep. For example, this is often used in the automotive industry where there's multiple cores running. Depending on the solution, they run the same software or they run software that's the same but decoupled in time. But they're used to verify each other, just to put some more assurances on the software being executed correctly. And that's exactly what we are trying to exploit using fault injection, to make sure that this software is being executed incorrectly. So the paper where this was described is called Safety is Not Security, and this already hints a bit to the fact that this lockstep mechanism in the automotive industry is not designed and implemented for security, but it's done for safety. Because, for example, if you have a very important controller for the steering of your car, you want to make sure that this software gets executed correctly, because otherwise your car might steer automatically the wrong direction. But they've shown that on dual core versions of these lockstep chips, it is possible with a very high success rate to actually inject glitches within this system. So this shows that these features are not effective against security, but it also shows that actually fault injection attacks are applicable to multiple core chips. And for example, also the research that Christopher already talked about escalating privileges in Linux, I can tell you it's not in the paper, but this has also been performed on multi-core systems where multiple cores were running at the same time. So again, this does not hold up in practice. It's a good reasoning, it definitely impacts the attack, but it does not prevent it. Another thing that you often hear, and this is typically coming from the manufacturers that are affected by fault injection attack, for example, is that physical access is required, and therefore the impact is minimal. Because somebody needs to open your phone, or somebody needs to put wires or make modifications to the PCB. But one thing that we already know, we touched upon that already, is that there's things that are driven by software. So you do need to have physical access. For example, RowHammer is based on the fact that you, by reading out specific locations in DRAM, you can flip bits in the rows that are next to these locations. And this allows you to inject these bit flips in either security critical code or, for example, crypto primitives. Now, another variant is actually clock screw, and there's also, we briefly referred to it. The idea here is that by software, you can actually change the voltage and the frequency supplied to the chip. So by making configuration changes to these two settings, it allows you to run a chip outside of its expected conditions, exactly what you would be doing with voltage glitching. So you're running either the chip too fast with the too low voltage or the other way around, but it allows you to make the circuit within the chip misbehave in a similar fashion as you would do as you would shoot a laser on the chip. So the key point here is that these hardware vulnerabilities are triggered by software, and this means that you can trigger these vulnerabilities remotely. So you do not need physical access. So let's walk you through an example of using RowHammer in order to escalate privileges in Linux, in similar fashion as to what Christopher showed, but using a different method. So again, we're using a target with a hardware vulnerability that we want to trigger somehow, but we want to do this remotely. So we're bound to fault injection techniques which can be driven by software. And the ones we know of for now are clock screw and RowHammer. In this case, we will use RowHammer. So from software, we're accessing the DDR continuously in order to generate these bit flips in subsequent rows. So the injection in this case is some sort of electric field injection. It's a bit, this name is a bit arbitrarily chosen because it's a bit hard to say what's going on exactly. But we think electric field may be a good name for this. It's also not so important in the end. We all know what RowHammer does. And based on the fact how often you access the row and which rows, these are actually your glitching parameters. So these are kind of a way to shape the glitch, because you want your bits to flip in the right locations. So you need to tune your glitch in order to have it at the right locations. This would be very similar as doing it at the right moment in time or having a laser at a specific place on the chip. So if we have found the right location, we can actually inject a glitch that manifests itself again in a fault. And in this case, we are actually corrupting the data that's stored in an external chip. But it's important to realize we are now not talking about the microcontroller or we're talking about the system on chip. We're talking about injecting faults in an external memory chip. Again, these faults can be modeled, so you can model that you can maybe flip one bit or two bits. And with Rowhammer, you do not know upfront how many bits you're going to flip. It depends on the DDR chip. So you need to somehow make an educated guess on which bits are going to flip and where those bits then will be flipped in the data or code you're interested in. So once you figure this out, you can mount an exploit. And for example, what Google Project Zero did is they figured out where the page table entries are stored in external DDR. And this allows them to modify the access rights within these physical pages. And this allows them to, in the end, achieve their goal, which is actually escalating privileges in Linux. Using a software-driven but hardware triggering vulnerability that manifests itself as an attack that fully compromises the system remotely. So again, physical access is required for many fault injection techniques, but not for all. So this is definitely also does not hold up as absolutely as this. Another one that's very interesting, it's something that Christoffer really likes a lot, so I will give the word to him. This is something that's close to his heart.
Thank you, Nix. By the way, if you have, as I was mentioning, the hardware vulnerability is actually rooted in physics. If you have questions on the physics behind some attacks, I'm available offline for having questions on why things will actually work. And this is also related to what we are discussing, because in a way, the way we are injecting glitches with Rowhammer is by affecting the nearby rows and the content in memory by just accessing the rest, still this, the physics. So this is one way. But those bit flips in memory could be caused by also something else. For example, also the other attack, ClockScrew, which relies on controlling the voltage and the clock from software of the system, might also cause those bit flips. So in the end, we should already guess that the way of causing that bit flips may be relevant or not depending on the situation. Actually, there is a misconception that fault attacks are actually depending on a specific injection techniques. And I think that the literature often thinks your injection technique with your goal, like voltage fault injection to bypass secure boot. So you're injecting voltage and then you achieve the secure boot. Or laser injection in order to weaken the RSA key, like you could do that only with laser. So for some reason, this idea has been just stored in our memory that we connect the way we inject something with the goal. And this might suggest that if you don't have the technique, then you're not able to reach that goal, which we don't think is true. Actually, the first thing we must say is that there is no systematic comparison of faults available. So you cannot easily compare what a laser does here on this subsystem, on OTP controller, for example, against what the voltage glitch would be doing on flash memory, or against what EM would do on DDR. They can be all used in a way for an attack, which might have the same goals, but there is no way of, there is no, in literature, no comparison done in this way. But what we know is that if you have a one-fault model, like we were discussing, so flipping one bit, you can actually achieve that through different techniques. So you have fault models applicable to many techniques. So this means that, we are going to see that in a moment, that your exploitation that uses those faults can be independent. Think about for a moment, ClockScrew. So in this ClockScrew attack, the software controls what are called DVFS register. Which are basically for voltage and frequency scaling of the chip. The physics behind this attack is the following. You vary the clock frequency of the target in a way that makes the target a bit unstable while it's working, and you also lower the voltage in a way that the timing of propagation of information within the chip is not up to par with the required clock. So you desynchronize the transmission of the information within the chip. And you can do that because there are IPs, there are registers of the DVFS, digital voltage frequency scaling, which are needed for the kernel to say, hey, let's go low power mode, let's consume less energy. When on mobile phones, we don't need to drain the battery, go to sleep, U core, go down. In order to do so, there is something that needs to orchestrate the energy management, and DVFS are a very key point in mobile phones for doing so. But these registers are accessible. And when you control the power, you control the power for each single core. So one core can decide through this register how much power or how much frequency will be another core running at. And this is a very important point in the research, because this allows one core to inject glitch in execution that would cause faults in the execution of another core. And if you are changing the execution of another core, you may cause faults that may allow one storage or one value to be changed. And let's assume that this fault model, this is the fault model of the attack, let's assume that these changes do happen in the AES state of an AES crypto computation, cryptographic computation. If you're able to change one byte, basically, then you are able to apply the EFE attack and extract the key. They did extract the AES key from a trusted application running in a trusted execution environment. Why is that possible? Is that possible because the execution happens within the same system, and the voltage and the clock of that system can be decided by another core. So basically you have one core which is running in RE, so outside, which can decide the voltage and the frequency for the core which is executing the TE in that moment. So this means that your hardware is actually pretty agnostic across security domains. And this is a very powerful idea. So this is how this clock screw attack actually achieved the goal. But let's think about another unknown attack. For some other reason. Another attack which is completely different requires instead hardware access. So instead of controlling registers, you actually inject faults or clock. Let's assume it's voltage for a moment. And you do perform voltage glitching. Well, of course, you might be able to, this glitch to cause and trigger another different vulnerability. So this means that the faults that you generate, the yellow oval over there, are different, are very likely to be different. And even the percentage of the different faults may be complete distribution, may be completely different. You may be causing faults, I don't know, in the CPU decoding, or other than faults, let's say, in the DDR itself. They are completely different. But as long as the faults that have been caused do fall, even a few, within the fault model that you have chosen, such as one byte modification in the S state for this application, which is one byte modification here, it becomes irrelevant how you cause them. This means that your exploitation becomes independent of all these things. So basically you write the same shell code. You use the same addresses. It doesn't change. So this means that if you switch from one attack, one injection technique to another, you may be able to completely reuse what happens for the fault leveraging. So the attack will work if the faults fall within your chosen fault model, because the exploitation has been designed to use those faults. And that is the important part. So this means that if you want to switch from EM to laser and do the same attack and achieve secure boot with the same fault model, you just put EM aside, put laser on the bench in order to do that. But it is likely the chance that your software, your memory layout, your preparation from a software point of view will not change. So we think that we need to discard the idea that the attacks are linked to injection. So thinking that laser can do this means also that if you don't have laser and unable to do that, that should be rejected. And for the next one, I would like to involve Nick. I think that you also like this one.
Glitch resolution.
This is the wrong microphone.
Glitch resolution is key to success. So, typically, what we hear is that the glitch resolution that you need to have in order to change one instruction or one particular bit in some data field needs to be quite short. And it's true, shorter glitches definitely have some advantages. One example, for example, is that the longer your glitch is, the less clear it becomes where your glitch actually has an effect. Similar thing you could think of a laser. If the spot size of the laser is very big, you probably target multiple components. If it gets a bit unclear what gets corrupted when. But even though that's the case, it might not always be needed to have a super small laser spot or a super tiny glitch in time. Because, for example, if you look at this graph, and this is something we like to do when we're doing fault injection, we like to graph our experiments on a two-dimensional axis. So on the left side, on the y-axis, you see actually the voltage that's being supplied to the target. The numbers that you see is they somehow needs to be translated to voltage, but let's say this voltage goes from 0 to 3.3. And on the x-axis, you see actually the glitch length. So that's the width of the pulse that we inject in the voltage signal. So what you see here is that the green area are all the combinations between glitch voltage and glitch length where the target did not misbehave at all. So there was no observable change. On the bottom right, you see a larger yellow area, and this is actually where the glitch was probably too strong because the target was not able to communicate anymore. The target reset actually. And within those two regions, between the green and the yellow, you see some blue, which are actually exceptions. So they're CPU exceptions. They include things like illegal instructions, store prohibited, things like this. But on the area between the green and the yellow, you see all these red dots appear. And these are actually successful glitches. So, and these are the same type of successful glitches. So they're the same type of faults. So we were assuming a fault model that was very specific, and we colored the experiments that were actually adhering that fault model red. So what you can see is that the successful glitches are actually spread out in the entire graph. And this shows that the same type of fault manifests itself with shorter glitches and with much longer glitches. So in similar reason, Yifan came to the similar look conclusion, where he started removing capacitors from his PlayStation experiments. But at some point he figured out that he could get the same type of faults on boards which were not modified and which were modified. So there he made a conclusion similar as that what we usually made the conclusion of, that it's not always needed to make sure that the glitch is as narrow as possible. The key lesson here is just start first trying before you actually start modifying your setup. Because if you start removing capacitors from the target, you get other trouble as well. Your target might not boot anymore, or your target may become unstable. And this also actually affects the experiments, especially if you consider that these experiments are typically run over more than just a few minutes. They typically run for days. So we would like to say glitch resolution is definitely not key to success. Trying various things out is, actually. Another interesting one is the success rate. I cannot even recall how often I get the question, and this especially in an academia context, what is the success rate? And they want to hear a percentage. Well, one thing to realize, maybe if you're not familiar with fault detection, is that the success rate of a fault attack is typically less than 100%, unfortunately. So let's assume there's two attacks. And the question I have for you, which one is more effective? So attack A has a 1% success rate. So one attack in 100 attempts is successful. And you can do 10 attempts per minute. For example, this is an attack you need to do during boot. So you need to wait for the target boot. It takes a long time. Attack B has a 0.1% success rate, but you can perform thousands of 1,000 attempts per minute, and that means you can do thousands per hour. For example, you perform this attack during runtime, and you found a way to prevent the chip from crashing all the time. Well, as you can imagine already, the second one is better, because you get more success within 1 minute than the attack A. So this shows that the success rate itself, the absolute success rate, only provides the fault frequency. It still gives you some information, but it doesn't paint the whole picture. And it doesn't really provide you the number you need for determining the impact of an attack. So the feasibility we'd like to stress is better described by an average time for success rather than an average attempt for success. So again, this myth, we also like to say, it is kind of rejected. It's better to focus on the time you need to perform an attack than the amount of attempts you really need, because you miss some information there. Another interesting one, and this is again coming often from the manufacturers, is that fault injection attacks do not scale. Well, I mean, in a way, they don't. Not considering the software-driven ones, because they actually are a good exception to what fault injection attacks normally are about. But fault injection attacks itself, especially if you think of things like laser, EMFI, you really need to open things, you need to make modifications. It's very difficult to do it on the second target. Maybe the setup making takes just as much as time. So the scalability of attacks is difficult. But it's important to realize that the results of these attacks are certainly scalable. The idea with fault injection typically is, and you'll see that later also, is that getting assets out once is very powerful because you can use these assets forever. And these assets are typically things like code, some data, the keys of the device. So once you have them out using a sophisticated attack like fault injection that is not scalable, you can freely distribute the assets to other people via the internet, for example. So what do you think all these gaming consoles have in common? other than that they are used for playing games, obviously. They're actually all being attacked using hardware attacks. They're attacked using fault injection attacks in order to get various assets out, whether those are keys, whether those are, for example, the boot ROM, which is mapped out during boot, but by breaking into the secure boot chain at the early stage, you can recover the boot ROM and find the vulnerability and exploit that, roughly what happened on the Nintendo Switch. And you see this happen on the gaming consoles quite often, because for these gaming consoles, the attackers are quite determined in order to accomplish something. So they are not bothered by not having tooling or not bothered by having to inject glitches in high-powered chips. They just make it work. And it's not like they're using professional tooling. They just make proof of concepts that work once or twice and that provide them access to these assets, and then they forget about it. So that fault injection attacks do not scale, I didn't really debunk this, but it definitely does not hold up for the results of these attacks. And it's a bit of a discussion if the results of an attack are included in the attack or not. I would vote that they are included. Implementing countermeasures, also often a remark we get at the end of a presentation. Somebody raised their hand, and why don't you just install a brownout detector or a glitch detector and get rid of these attacks entirely? Well, it's kind of true, and there's other things you can do, like adding random delays, adding additional checks, and all these things make it more complicated to perform a certain attack. But they do not really prevent it, because let's have a look at our model again. So we can use this model in order to reason about countermeasures at different moments in time, but also at different levels. For example, during the activation, we can prevent access to the control registers that determine the frequency or the voltage. We can install active shields that prevent the injection part as a whole. We can detect the glitch, for example, using brownout detectors, optical sensors. It's all valid points. We can put more assurances in the data that's stored in external memory, for example, using ECC RAM. We can start implementing countermeasures in software. For example, we do redundant checks. It's very easy to put more checks on something you want to verify. For example, you verify the outcome of a signature verification twice. You can also think of random delays, because one thing to realize is that fault injection attacks, especially if you talk about bypassing checks, you need to inject that glitch at the moment the check is being performed. Otherwise, you cannot bypass this check. So we're making sure that this check does not happen at the same moment in time. It will be more difficult to actually perform this attack. And the good thing is, all these countermeasures, and these are just examples at these levels, they all stack. You can all implement them at the same time. And probably it will make the attack much more difficult. However, when you start implementing them, it's very important to realize a few things. Software countermeasures, they're typically specific to the exploitation part, because simply you cannot implement them before, because you need software to be executed. And typically, they're modeled around a specific fault model. So you assume that you, for example, can skip an instruction, bypass a check. Let's do the check twice, and let's make sure that skipping an instruction does not lead to an exploitable fault. And the important key here is that they do not prevent the injection part. So the physical part, the physics part of the fault injection attack still holds up. The fault still propagates, but the impact is less. Hardware countermeasures can actually prevent the injection technique. And typically, these hardware countermeasures are specific to an injection technique, but some hardware countermeasures are also applicable to all injection techniques. For example, ECC RAM, doesn't matter how you inject the glitch, it will actually work and put some assurances on the data for all the injection techniques. But the key point here is that when you start thinking about countermeasures, you really need to start taking a systematic approach. You cannot just simply glue together all sorts of countermeasures at different levels and hope it works. And let's try to actually do that.
Yep, I think it's very important. Now we've seen a number of countermeasures. Let's see how we can change the stage in order to actually bypass them. The first thing that we need to realize that when you have a glitch, actually many things happen. And then these things are all rooted in physics, but they do propagate the different layers and levels in the system. So when you inject one glitch, multiple faults may occur in the system at the same time. And sometimes they make just your system reset or just mute or you don't know what happens. But some may be actually useful for what you're doing. The first manifestation of the fault is actually at the physical level, because that's where they come from, physics, that make your ship misbehave. And of course, I mean, this will have an effect on the actual circuit, where your logical gates will not have enough energy to represent the value, or your memory cells are actually being modified and corrupted, or your flip-flops are not sampling data at the right time. So this is where things can actually go wrong in the circuit level. And if we are focusing on, in this nice paper from UC in 2018, on the units that execute code, there is also some microarchitecture, maybe microcode or just hardware logic. And if you think that this may happen during the decoding instruction, you already know or understand why, basically, an instruction can actually get corrupted. It's still all the physics, but the effects that you have are up the stack at the same time along the stack. So this is where the boundary where instruction actually starts to appear, and this is where your software lives usually with control flow and data flow of the program. So regardless of where the root cause is, this stack actually of fault arrive to the point where they become visible to you, or to the point where they become interesting for you. So usually, these have been more like instruction skipping, so we can skip this instruction, or these have been modeled like data corruption. Maybe we can flip this bit in the AES state. This is the usual thinking. And this means that, for example, in the case of secure boot, if you along these lines, the typical attack is by skipping a signal check. If the signature is valid, you continue. And because the risk is conditional, if you skip the instruction that makes the comparison, chances are that you will go in the wrong control flow part. And this is usually what happens in this kind of attacks, where your fault model is called instruction skipping. And by trying many times, statistically, it will happen sooner or later. It may happen if the hardware is vulnerable, that the signal check is skipped. And this means that your code flow actually changes, goes in the direction of good secure boot while it's not happening. So you're providing a wrong image, a malicious image. Chances are that you have thought about this attack and that your countermeasures are actually there. And this means that your attack may be blocked. And the countermeasures are, for example, like we do the check twice, so you need to bypass the check twice. We do the check 3 or 4 times, so you need to glitch all of them. And which makes sense if you think that your model is actually skipping an instruction and bypassing a check. And this is what the industry has been done until now. Basically. But now that we know that there are different faults happening in the stack in different way, we can actually use them in a different way. From 2016, we have this nice tool or fault model we are using, which is instruction modification. So instead of focusing on skipping instruction, now we want to modify instruction, right? So if we happen that the instruction modification actually assigns, as we have seen, a different value in program counter, the program counter immediately goes to the execution of the flow with program control, program counter control. So this means that the software where the countermeasure are placed is not executed. So this means that your software countermeasure is basically useless over there. You just switched at a different level, and you use that in a different way. Let's have another example, the last one, just to give you the idea how switching fault model can actually use that. Let's try to use a different layer. There is, we add a different, an additional layer to the paper. Basically, we don't have a paper for that, but I think this is also missing. It's a subsystem. So you know that there are OTP, where the settings are stored, that says, that, okay, secure boot is enabled, or encryption is enabled, and all these things. These settings are in the OTP controller, and they are transferred to what are called shadow register. And then the CPU reads this value for understanding. You remember the start of the presentation. If the OTP secure boot is enabled, then you go secure boot. If you flip the bit while they are being transferred to the shadow register, you may have enabled that in the OTP configuration, but completely disabled in the OTP, in the configuration that the CPU sees. So this means that CPU says, okay, secure boot is not enabled, and it will continue executing your malicious code because the check is not being done, because the setting has been presented to the CPU as not existing. So we are not even going to the instruction. You are attacking the subsystem, but the effect is the same. Your software countermeasure will never trigger because they should not be even used in first place, because we are using a different fault model. So the basic lessons here is that most software countermeasure can be bypassed by choosing faults happening in a different layer and leveraging that in a different way. So you need to change your exploitation of those faults. And the fact also, B point is that the countermeasures are based on attack-specific assumptions. You assume that I'm using those faults only, which is basically where the weakness is. And this shows also why the defenses cannot be implemented using only software, but you need hardware for supporting your defenses. So we think that actually implementing countermeasure is easy, and we are basically at the wrap-up of our presentation, and I think it's time to make a few takeaways here. But first, did we really debunk all these myths? Well, we tried to propose something that actually provides plausible deniability. We think that we should reflect upon these things much more than what is being currently done, because we think there are options both for better defenses and better attacks over here. And the takeaway is that we need to communicate. There are big knowledge gaps between community, academia, and industry, all big actors over here, and we need consolidation, because otherwise we come to incorrect conclusions. And if we reach a new common understanding, we already shown that by switching different parts in the equation, we can reach great attacks, which are not necessarily expected at this point. But the key point is that the fault injection has reached the masses. With new attacks, with new possibility, I think it's here to stay and will not go away. And we are ready for questions, and we are also happy to take even outside the room. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Cristofaro and Nick. Are there any questions from the audience? None? Then we'll go to the Sliders.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
We still have questions on the slide.
I'm sorry. So, yes. Can your FI techniques jailbreak iPhone like Checkmate?
I can answer that one. First of all, we need to make the assumption that the iPhone is vulnerable to fault injection, which, as far as I know, has not been presented publicly. But let's assume it is. So if it is, Checkmate relies on a software vulnerability in order to jailbreak the iPhone. And these type of software vulnerabilities are exactly what you can inject using fault injection. Typically, what we like to say is you can actually create your own software vulnerability. For example, you can bypass a check somewhere. You can change an instruction, which actually manifests itself like having a software vulnerability in the, for example, the boot ROM, or another stage is executed at the early stage, which is required for a jailbreak.
Yeah, basically the point is that if the hardware is vulnerable to some fault injection techniques, because if it is, then you might have used that kind of sensibility, susceptibility to that technique in order to implement some of the attacks that we actually discussed. I think that's the key point that you should always ask. If it is vulnerable, then you can probably find ways through that.
Yeah, and as far as we know, and as far as there's public information about this, there's nothing in the iPhone that should prevent these type of attacks.
You are not aware at the moment here. Which actually brings us to the next question, that does the attack where you control PC work on authenticated PXN like the new ARM chip? I think it's referring to pointer authentication, basically, to PAC. I would like to take on this question. Well, it depends on... when you are in this kind of situation, basically, you are achieving a program counter control as you would do in a normal software attacks, as you would do in normal buffer overflows, okay? The only thing is that the buffer overflow is not there. So we actually take the PC control. So this means that all the countermeasure that prevent reaching that control in software, like stack cookies, would not be relevant for us. So we don't care about stack cookies because we take control of PC immediately. But then all the countermeasure which do apply to the control flow, like pointer authentication, actually do matter, and we would be more or less in the same situation as any attacker that would be in control of PC. So no difference on that. The point is that we don't need a software vulnerability to achieve that point. That is the key difference.
We won't be able to, I'm afraid because of time limitations, we won't be able to ask any more questions. But
yes.
Of course, Nick,
I have one question. Can you forward us the questions so we will answer them on Twitter?
Yeah, and then we can do that.
That would be great. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Please give us one more, a big applause for the speakers.